Good afternoon, everyone. Okay. So I have no punchlines. I'll be speaking in English. I don't know Hindi, and you won't be able to bear my Hyderabadi Hindi if I even attempt. But I think what I'm really going to be covering today is telling you straight what it needs, what for each one of you to succeed in organizations. What's happening in the world? How is it impacting organization culture? What are the changes that you all will be, each one of you will have to make as individuals to be successful, to survive in the new era that there is? So without going too much into broader context, I would like to term culture simply as the amalgamation of various patterns, thinking and attitudes amongst people, ways of life, ways of behavior, repeated actions amongst people in a community. When the people of a particular place repeatedly follow some of the popular trends being developed within, or let's say in more simple terms, the way the people behave in a society, that really forms the culture of that particular country or community. Indian culture is indeed a beautiful composition of old, established, traditional and ethnic trends and patterns, since India is a secular country and it possesses the people belonging to varied backgrounds. Hence, its diversity makes our India a culturally diverse nation and also symbolizes a vast heritage of ancient culture. However, what we do need to confront is that cultural identity is not fixed. Cultural change, as anthropologists tell us, begins with the process of innovation, of which cultural borrowing, that means we may want to borrow from other cultures across the world, or diffusion, that is maybe moving out some of the negative behaviors which are there within our culture, which is most common. And it can also be precipitated by social acceptance, by selective elimination, and by integration. So today I would really like to focus on progress and the impact of culture at an organization level. How do you, as future employees, entrepreneurs, innovators, brace yourself to be successful in a new paradigm? I'm really not going to be talking about our traditions as well as our social behaviors. I'm going to be focusing purely on what it means for each one of you to be successful within an organization. So the organizations that exist today in a variable environment that is directly affected by the process of globalization. Do all of you understand what is globalization? Yes? Okay, good. So all this leads to many social changes in the national culture on which depends the organization culture, ethical behavior and values in an organization. The impact of globalization does not solely refer to the cultural segment. On the contrary, the impact is felt on the economy where certain global values are created, values which are basis for development and advancement to the business. Although globally there may be many differences between the cultures and even opposing value systems, globalization imposes a significant impact in changing the communication processes and certain transformations, especially countries in transition, such as ours. In order to facilitate communication between organizations of the same or similar activities needing more frequent cooperation. In this regard, the process of homogenization, that is, various cultures becoming similar in different fields, is increasingly happening and is more noticeable, which is reflected in an organization performance. In this way, the economic globalization provides the countries in the world many development opportunities that can serve as a good example of organizations that are currently joining the process of conquering the global market. Globalization is actually considered to be a result of the development of knowledge, above all the development of technology that has enabled the creation of organizations without borders, the development of science, economics, management, and the development of many other areas that have a direct impact on the development of globalization. Today, the tendency towards creation of a single market allows free flow of goods and capital, better availability of information, monitoring of competition, availability of labor force, and many other benefits. With such movements, one can truly say that today's world is categorized not only by globalization but by liberalization as well, and a high degree of technological development which greatly influence the overall economic processes. In this context, when there's a significant interaction between geographic regions, when a significant impact is exercised between different geographic regions, the result is a change of many previously established cultural relations for which all those who intend to succeed in the global market need to adapt. For organizations to participate in international markets, communicate and compete, it is necessary for their organizations to adapt to the market context they perform in. The consequence is the world of separate states is said to be ending if the process of globalization is truly allowed to run its due course. The new technology based on computer and satellite communication have indeed revolutionized our radio, television, and video programs are now being transposed into the multimedia world of cyberspace and available to all people wherever they may live. So do all of you all understand the first, second, third, and the fourth industrial revolutions? Have you heard about what is the fourth industrial revolution? No, okay. So essentially, the current phase that all economies are going through is what we call the fourth industrial revolution. So just stepping back a little bit, in the mid 17th century, the nature of work changed when rural agrarian societies shifted to become urban and industrial. Economic growth meant going underground for energy, so we had coal mines, etc. And then that's when the advent of factories started for manufacturing. Then later what happened was that technology slowly took over, and because of rising demand and need for more of the manufacturing take place, machines started taking over what man was doing and therefore manufacturing around the clock. Today what we're going through is called the fourth industrial revolution and is transforming practically every human activity, the way we make things, the way we use our resources, the way we communicate, the way we interact, the way we learn, the way we work, the way we govern, and the way we do business. Its scope, speed, and reach are unprecedented. Scholars believe that the fourth industrial revolution is the greatest transformation human civilization has ever seen. As far-reaching as previous industrial revolutions were, they never set such enormous transformative path. Just think of it, 10 years ago, none of us even heard of a smartphone. Today, none of us leave our houses without one. A few decades ago, the internet connected computers just at a few sites. Today, practically every human being can connect to a network that spans the globe and provides access to a great repository of information and knowledge ever created by mankind. So if we get the revolution right, digitalization, does everybody understand digitalization here? Yeah, there must be people who are doing IT. Do all of you understand digitalization? Yes? Okay. So, in the fourth industrial revolution, it's estimated that almost 10 billion humans inhabiting the planet will be impacted by digitalization. That's why the fourth industrial revolution is not just about technology and business, it's about society. How digitalization is going to be impacting the way we live, the way we behave. So today, a computer can beat us at any game. Bots are writing texts. Machines talk to each other. But nevertheless, just remember that we as humans will define the algorithm that will govern the machines, and the machines would not be governing us. And also, we are writing the code that will shape our collective future. Today, stakeholders. Who are stakeholders? Basically, customers, shareholders, employees, political leaders, societies as a whole, rightfully expect companies to assume greater social responsibility by protecting the climate, fighting for social justice, training and educating workers. The business of business has become how to create value for society. Changes on the global scale have upended many familiar patterns globally, and talent and employers now see each other more on equal terms. Today, gone are the days when, you know, how many of your fathers have worked in organizations? How many of your fathers, mothers work for organizations? Nobody? Or nobody is listening to what I'm saying? Okay, I guess one or two generations back, there was something called lifelong employment. People joined an organization, continued to work there till they retired. Today we are talking about contracts, we are talking about freelancers. Anybody understands freelancers here? Yes, that's good. So lots of you are actually on, you know, getting onto some of those freelance sites. Yes? Okay, that's good. So basically what is happening is that no more is there full-time employment with employers. The kind of skills that are changing, point one, you will need to become lifelong learners. Perhaps in my generation, when I started my job, I said I finished my CA, now I can relax and I'm going to get into a job and I'm going to be there till I retire. But today there is no guarantee on employment. There are companies who are actually laying off thousands and thousands of people because they don't have the right skills. They have thousands of openings, but they don't have people to fill in because there's no availability of skills and talent. And why is this happening? Why are people being laid off? Because they are not understanding the need to be forever learners. How to continuously focus on upskilling oneself to face the kind of changes that are happening globally. An organization to be competitive, to be able to survive, has to compete globally today. And therefore, when there are so many changes in the skills that are required for organizations to compete globally, they will have no choice but to get rid of people or try and get people with the right skills. Therefore, it's very important that employers, society ensures that there's adequate learning programs for employees. But it's equally important that each one of you ensures that you're constantly upgrading yourselves to be relevant in this new world. The second is that, you know, the kind of human skills. So there are so many jobs which is not going to be existing. All of you have heard of artificial intelligence. You are hearing of robots. And there's this whole thing about, is machine going to take over man? And there's several day-to-day jobs that perhaps, you know, were some relevant even a decade ago, are vanishing because of automation. But there is only certain kind of work that machines can do. Today, human beings will be used for innovation, for creativity, knowledge, technology, technology design, complex problem solving, emotional intelligence, empathy. And these are all the new skills, behaviors that each one of us will have to learn to be able to succeed in the kind of jobs that are going to be available in the future. Just by learning how to write code is not going to ensure that you're going to be having lifetime employment, because very soon a computer is going to do it for you. So learn to build the kind of skills that human beings will need to have to be able to survive in the new world of automation. The third point is inclusivity and collaboration. Not only are we going to have multi-generational workforce, so today there are five generations of people working in an organization. Tomorrow, you guys are going to be taking up jobs. Maybe in a couple of years it's possible that somebody who's your dad's age is going to be reporting into you. And how are you going to have empathy? How are you going to ensure that you're sensitive, handling the entire scenario with respect and dignity? More and more, organizations, you will see, whether you talk about the new e-commerce companies, the new startups, they're all being started by the younger generations, and it's very possible that most of them will have people of older generations reporting into them. The fourth is distributed leadership vis-a-vis hierarchical. We are all used to a paternalistic environment, where you know, we listen to what our fathers and mothers tell us. You know, today there was a earlier session where they were saying that, can you tell your parents that you don't want to take up the career of their choice, but rather following your passion? So we have been used to listening to what our parents, our elders tell us. But more and more, teams are going to become smaller. There are going to be no top-down instructions. We are used to following instructions. Today, we will be in smaller, when you are getting to work, you will be in smaller teams. You will need to take independent decisions without waiting for instructions from a senior. And therefore, you know, management, decision making is going to be a key skill that each of you all will have to build. The fifth is the dynamics of genders. Now, gender parity is fundamental to whether and how societies and economies thrive. And therefore, it's important to understand implications of this on our families as well. In the Indian culture, men normally have been providing for the family, but this has changed. Men and women now both leave home in search of available jobs, and it's very possible, especially because, you know, there's a demand for different kinds of skills. There could be massive retrenchment. One may find that a man will have to be staying at home, taking care of the house and even the children, therefore taking on the role that a traditional woman played. Today, all the girls are educated, and it would be a shame if they focused on getting married or rearing kids rather than getting out there and fulfilling their ambitions. And how are men going to be able to handle this transition of the role of a woman in the household? I was listening to a very important... So I think there's a Surf ad which talks about share the load. I don't know whether you all saw it. So the guy and the woman come back from work. The woman is quickly rushing to make his cup of tea and get the dinner ready and get the clothes into the washing machine, where the guy thinks it's his birthright to sit down and chill out in front of the television. So I think the role of men and women in the household is changing enormously. Another point that I would like to add, you know, I was listening to a talk by Indra Nui recently. Do all of you know Indra Nui? Yeah. So she was talking about how can we take the Asian style of families back to the West. The kind of support systems that we have from our elders who could be taking care of our children, and how in turn we take care of them, you know, during their older age. The concept of the joint family slowly dying down, and even in India we are moving towards nuclear families, but somewhere I think we need to preserve some of those traditions if more women will need to get out there and get into the job market. So I think I've kind of covered you know, whatever I wanted to say, but in a nutshell what I'm trying to say is that we are seeing the emergence of a universal culture which is based on values, adherence to civil rights, gender equality, respect for property, acceptance of market forces as a mechanism for resources. I just want to end by saying that let's not adopt cultures blindly. When I talked about you know, adopting certain cultures which are prevalent in other countries, let's take the best of what it would suit for us to progress as a nation, for us to progress as individuals and be successful in our careers in the organizations that we are working for. Take a simple example of, you know, today there's a huge trend towards desi ghee. So cow ghee is becoming a huge trend in the West. You know, haldi doodh, which perhaps our grandmothers gave us when we were, you know, young, we had a bad cold. Turmeric milk is a big trend, you know, in the West. Yoga, meditation, mindfulness, huge trend in the West. So some parts of it that we are slowly forgetting about. How many of us really practice meditation or yoga, Ayurveda, following Ayurveda, which today is a big trend in the West. So they are adopting the best of what perhaps a country like India can offer them. But what are we adopting? Coke, burgers, pizzas. So let's make a conscious choice of what is right for us to adopt, what is not right for us to adopt. Make sure that what we adapt is going to be making us more successful as a nation and as citizens of the country. Thank you.